Let's pray. Father God, we thank you today for the entrance of your word, which bringeth light. Today, O God, be a fence around us. Allow us a safe space, God, to process, to present, and most of all, God, to become the manifestation of your majesty that you desire. We pray today for Pastor Kenny in his absence and traveling mercies upon him in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to start in Genesis today. I want to start in Genesis, which of course means beginning. I actually thought I was finished with this text, and then I was this morning poked in the side by Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, one and the same, and was told that I had forgotten the most important part, because before we learn to pick up our vulnerability, which is an expression of our worship, we need it in its proper context. It's not weakness, it's meekness, which is strength under control. And sometimes as men, we have to live in two universes. We are forced to be savages and saints at the same time. You got to protect everything under your watch, but then you got to also be the watchman on the wall. And so as we juxtapose one against the other, sometimes it can get confusing and it becomes a conundrum. And so we need to do the research and find out where we lost our vulnerability initially. And of course, it wasn't us directly. It was inherited. Now, the good news is 1 Corinthians 15:45 says the first Adam was a living soul. The last Adam, Jesus Christ, was a quickening spirit. So we can get it back, but we have to make a conscious decision to become vulnerable again. So in Genesis 2:25 is where we will start our journey today. 2:25. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. Vulnerability. When we think of vulnerability, sometimes in our limited thinking, we think it only to be an expression of an unprotected space. But in this particular context, this is prior to the fall of man, which happens in Genesis 3. And we are in an eternal state with God and not an ephemeral one, right? And in this state, there is nothing hidden before God. Boy, if we could get back there. And so literally they walk around, not just physically nude. I don't so much want you to remember that, as I want you to remember that there was no obstruction between them and God. There was no obstruction. Well, you're saying, well, what might the obstruction be? Well, you got a job, don't you? You got a honey-do list, you got kids, you got grandkids, you got issues that you consider to be pressing, right? These things begin to build a distance. And they don't always have to be sex, drugs, and rock and roll. It can be things that you have deemed as decent and wholesome, and yet they obscure the vision of God in your life. Instead of you finding yourself with God time, you end up with good times. And so you have to be careful to remain vulnerable. So the prototype for man was vulnerability before God. They were naked, and the Bible says not ashamed. And that word ashamed in the Hebrew vernacular literally means that they were not disappointed. They had an open relationship with God. The Bible says in the New Testament, all things are open and bare before him with whom we have to do. We were created not to be covered up. But over the years, as men, we put on layers. We put on layers. So they start in the garden with a perfect start. But a funny thing happens on the way to paradise. Genesis 3:10-11. And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked. Uh-oh. The narrative has changed. In the span of a few verses, which we don't know the absolute time, we can't quantify it, he went from not realizing that he had nothing between him and God to thinking he had to hide something from God. Just that quick. Watch this. And I hid myself, he said. And God asked what is seemingly a rhetorical question, but we know it isn't. He said, who told thee thou was naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree thereof? I have commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat. All knowledge ain't good knowledge. And there is some things that happen to us in our lives that cause us to put on cover, right? We don't like to talk about it as men. We like to think that we're removed from it, but molestation, humiliation, degradation, low self-esteem, people who spoke in our lives, but instead of speaking blessings, they spoke curses. Raised in a hostile environment. They only did what they knew, but they didn't know God. Yeah. These things contribute to your clothing, the layers that you put on, because then you feel a sense of urgency to protect yourself. Here's what he says in Genesis 3 and 7. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Now, it is a joke to believe we can hide anything from God, right? We realize that, but they were under the assumption that if they could cover it up, they wouldn't be seen. And nothing heals if it's buried. Nothing heals if it's buried. So as they put the leaves on, the fig leaves, they're actually having more than a physical cover. They're putting some distance between them and God because they're removing themselves from the ability to be open and bare with God. You live long enough, it happens. It happens. And it ain't just church attendance or reading your Bible. We all have dark spaces in our lives that we would rather God not look at. And sometimes instead of an honest dialogue where we are open and bare before him, we try to closet it. Genesis 3 and 21. Unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord God make coats of skin and clothe them. So he puts more clothing on them. And this is a sad commentary because at this point, the relationship between us and him has changed. Instead of being in the garden, not only physically naked, but see-through and actually available to God, there has begun to be a distance. And the distance will only increase because by the time we get through Genesis 3, the fall of man, the father is putting the son and the daughter-in-law out of the apartment. They'll be leaving Genesis and they'll be an angel with a flaming sword that will be assigned there so that they don't return. As men, often the space that should be safe for us is not. We ought to have a place where we can be vulnerable and not have to exercise our pride and keep things to ourselves. But unfortunately, this isn't always possible. As a matter of fact, many times, the very space we should be safe in, we are not. Genesis 4 and 8. And Cain talked with Abel, his brother, and it came to pass that when they were in the field, that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. First murder is committed by a brother. Not a savage stranger. Someone in the inner sanctum of his life. A space and a place where he should have been able to share his hopes, dreams, aspirations, his fears. And instead of being safe there, he is savagely murdered. There is more than one type of murder. You can have character defamation occur in a relationship where people speak ill of you and drag your name through the mud. It really ain't your name, it's God's, but for the sake of this conversation, let's say it's yours. Another place we should be safe that often we are not. 2 Samuel 6, 16, 20 and 21. And as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Micah, Saul's daughter, looked through a window and saw David leaping and dancing before the Lord. And she despised him in her heart. Then David returned to bless his household. And Micah, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, how glorious was the king of Israel today who uncovered himself today in the eyes of the handmaidens of his servants, as one of the vain fellows shamelessly uncovereth himself. And David said unto Michal, it was before the Lord, which chose me before thy father and before all his house, to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord, over Israel. Therefore, I will play before the Lord. This should have been a safe space for him. This was his wife. This should have been his best friend, his confidant. She should have held his secrets tight. Instead of divulging something as disrespectful as the dialogue that she says about how embarrassing it must have been for you to publicly display and convey your love for God. A safe space violated. A sanctum that is non-existent. Unfortunately, sometimes this happens. Job 2, 8 through 10. And he took him a potsherd to scrape himself withal, and he sat down among the ashes. Then said his wife unto him, dost thou still retain thy integrity? Curse God and die. But he said unto her, thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil? In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. Now, she should have been on the team instead of opposed to it. Just plain and simple. But she is actually not a protagonist. She doesn't support him in his suffering. She is an antagonist. She allows the enemy to use her within the confines of her own house, a place he should be covered, protected, and respected. And she tells him, I don't know why you're still holding on to this notion of God. Finally, Job 8, 2 and 6. How long will thou speak these things? How long shall the words of thy mouth be like a strong wind? Doth God pervert justice, or doth the Almighty pervert justice? If thy children have sinned against him, and he have cast them away from for their transgression, if thou wouldest seek unto God betimes, and make thy supplication to the Almighty, if thou wert pure and upright, surely now he would awake for thee and make the habitation of thy righteousness prosperous. This is Job's friends. Well, we're using that word loosely. I don't know. They were supposed to come over and mourn with him. That was their job. Mourning don't take a lot of words, but instead he is assaulted in his own home. Not physically, mind you, but by something even stronger, words. Words. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me is actually not true. Not at all. The Bible says in Hebrews 11 and 3 that words are so profound and prolific that God created everything that is by speaking it into existence. That's why it is important in your vulnerability to only listen to certain voices. So they come over and literally what they say in plain English is, hey, buddy, you did something. God didn't just do this to you. But what if he wasn't doing it to him? He was doing it through him. Oh, nobody wants to talk about that. What if my vulnerability ain't even for me? What if it's for someone else? And so his wife has declared her independence. She ain't gonna deal with it. She want him to just cuss God and die. And then his friends who were supposed to come over and stand next to him in his hour of need, when he expressed his vulnerability, when he is naked and bare, here they come to bother him. Tell us what you did so we can intercede for you. I know you did something you didn't have any business. A helpmeet should help meet the needs and not help hurt. Here's what the Bible says in Micah 7, 5 through 6 concerning vulnerability, men. Trust ye not in a friend. Put ye not confidence in a guide. Keep the doors of thy mouth from her that lieth in thy bosom. For the son dishonoreth the father, and the daughter riseth up against her mother. The daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a man's enemies are the men of his own house. The exploitation of vulnerability is the specialty of the enemy. The devil likes to kick men when they're down. Because the only thing better than being anointed is the sadness that comes with feeling abandoned. And the enemy knows that. He will use romantic attachments. Judges 16, 15 through 19. And she said unto him, how canst thou say I love thee when thine heart is not with me? Thou hast mocked me these three times and hast not told me wherein thy great strength lieth. And it came to pass when she pressed him daily with her words and urged him so that his soul was vexed unto death, that he told her all his heart. Oh, my. Oh, my. And said unto her, thou hast not come a razor upon mine head. Now I have been a Nazarite unto God from my mother's womb. If I be shaven, then my strength will go from me, and I shall become weak and be like any other man. And when Delilah saw that he had told her all his heart, then the lords of the Philistines came unto her and bought money in their hand. And she made him sleep upon her knees, and she called for a man and caused him to shave off the seven locks of his head. And she began to afflict him, and his strength went forth. In the vulnerability of a relationship where a man feels like he can tell a woman all his dreams, hopes, aspirations, and desires, the ultimate betrayal occurs. He was a Nazarite. Numbers, the sixth chapter, is the Nazarite vow. And he shares this with her to his own demise. And she immediately betrays his trust. Be careful and prayerful about your vulnerability. And finally, if you needed a better example, the wisest and richest man in the world. 1 Kings 11, 4 and 9. For it came to pass when Solomon was old, that his wife turned away his heart from after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord, his God, as was the heart of David, his father. And the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned from the Lord God of Israel, which had appeared unto him twice. Listen, nobody is above having their vulnerability exploited. Least you think you were. We're reading about the wisest and richest man to ever live. 31 published Proverbs. There were over 2,000. And this man is hoodwinked. We better be careful. Another problem that expresses vulnerability for us as men is nepotism. Nepotism is a practice among those with power or influence of favoring relatives or friends or associates, especially by giving them jobs. You got an old son, you're going to get him down to the hall. Make sure he get his little 700 hours, he's going to get his life together. The minute he get in the union, he change. Talking to you sideways like you won't put your hands on him. Saying all manner of foolishness to your wife. You can't get him to do anything for you. You ain't the first. 1 Samuel 2, 12, 22 through 24 and 31 through 34. Eli was guilty of nepotism. He put the boys in the temple simply because they were his boys. I mean, after all, they're in the bloodline, right? They got to be decent, wholesome people. And they pimped and prostituted God's house to no end. They betrayed the sacred trust. Just because they got the same last name don't mean you should put them in the game. Forget your heart. You better check with the Holy Ghost. Everything ain't for everybody. Watch this. Now, the sons of Eli were sons of Belial. That means useless, worthless people. They knew not the Lord. Hold on. You done put folk in the temple that don't even know Jesus? You done made him the pastor and he ain't even saved? How'd that happen? Vulnerability. That's my boy. I got to provide for him. He ain't going to be all right if I don't. help him get set up somewhere. Okay. Now Eli was very old and heard all that his sons did unto Israel and how they lay with women that assembled at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And he said unto them, why do ye such things? For I hear of your evil doings by all this people. Nay, my sons, for it is not good report that I hear. Ye make the Lord's people to transgress. Behold, the days come that I will cut off thine arm and the arm of thy father's house, and there shall be not an old man in thine house. And thou shalt see an enemy in my habitation, and all the wealth which God shall give Israel. And there shall not be an old man in thine house forever. And the man of thine house, whom I shall not cut off from mine altar, shall be to consume thine eyes and to grieve thine heart. And all the increase of thine house shall die in the flower of their age. For this shall be a sign unto thee that shall come upon thy two sons, Hanophni and Phinehas. In one day they shall die, both of them. God said, well, I can't trust you to clean the house, so let me fix it. You have allowed your vulnerabilities to make you susceptible to your flesh. You put boys in there that not only were not decent human beings, but definitely were not priests. And it has become problematic. And so you will be assigned unto Israel the way I will cut your bloodline off. Our vulnerability can at times make us make bad decisions. We can feel obligated to overextend ourselves to someone based upon the fact that they're kinfolks. Here's another area of vulnerability that men suffer with that we need to be careful about. Pride. Who would have figured, right? 1 Chronicles 21, 1 through 4. And Satan stood up against Israel and provoked David to number Israel. And David said to Jacob and to the rulers of the people, go. Number Israel from Beersheba even to Dan, and bring the number of them to me, that I may know it. And Joab answered, the Lord make his people 100 times so many more as they be, but my Lord the king, are they not all the Lord's servant? He's trying to help him. He's trying to help him. In plain English, he said, I don't think it's a good idea, boss, for us to number these folks. After all, these ain't our folks, yeah. Right? The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. It was an act of pride, and we know it was pride because in the first verse it says, and Satan stood up. Okay. Well, Satan don't do nothing good. Right. And Satan is the author of pride. Pride got him thrown out of heaven and sent to earth. Ezekiel 28, Isaiah 12. Why then doth my Lord require this thing? Why will he be a cause for trespass to Israel? Joab said, pump your brakes, sir. Houston, we have a problem. If you do this, there's no turning back. And he was right. Nevertheless, the king's word prevailed against Joab. Wherefore, Joab departed and went throughout all Israel and came to Jerusalem. Pride. Pride. It's okay to be proud of what God has done. It's not okay to be proud, period. Arrogance, insolence. Started at the bottom, made it to the top, and now you refuse to be an asset to anybody. You're all liability. So as men, where is our place of refuge? Well, you didn't give us all this bad news. Where can we go then? Where can we go? I'm glad you asked. Proverbs 18 and 10. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into it and is safe. You can go to Jesus. You can go to Jesus. Yeah. You know that big fine house you got? You can create a sacred space in it with some nice carpet. And you can go in there and shut the door. And express the absolute full extent of your vulnerability before God and only God. You can lay before him, lay in him, lay on him, lay with him. and manifest his complete majesty through your worship. We are, I understand, raised to not be emotional creatures. We would rather they play football, hockey, and soccer than be painters and artists. But what if, just what if, emotionalism is the key to worship? What if the vulnerability you want him to dumb down or don't have because it challenges your picture of traditional manhood is the very way he will worship God? What if you're so busy trying to make him in your image, he can't be in God's? Psalms 91 and 2. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. That's where you put it all. Well, now you're trying to break up my marriage. Got to tell my wife everything. She ain't going to understand everything. Well, just keep on living. Y'all better ask some of these people in double digits. She ain't going to understand everything. Yeah, some things you and Jesus got to talk about first. Yeah, because all you're going to get is a crazy look and an invitation to the couch. That's what you're going to get. Yeah. Then you're going to go lay down and say, I actually said that too, didn't I? Yeah. Here's what David said in Psalms 34 and 6. This poor man cried. Uh-oh. Emotionalism. Well, that wasn't actually tears, Pastor. He cried out. There's a difference. When I cry out, I cry. I'm usually at a point of desperation by then. It's something beyond my scope. I can't handle it. And so I usually am at my wit's end. This poor man cried and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. Vulnerability is a prerequisite for worship. Don't lose yours. I'm going to say it again. Vulnerability is a prerequisite for worship. Don't lose yours. And here's the proof. Psalms 51. 16 and 17. Psalms 51, 16 and 17. For thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offering, the sacrifices of God. Here it is, y'all. Our broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart. O God, thou wilt not despise. You got to be broken to be fixed, guys. If you already got it together, what you doing here? There are no pros in Christianity. Everybody could wear the same shirt at different levels. We all under construction. You may have more tiers. You may have more walls up. You may have bigger rooms, but I ain't seen a complete house yet. The Bible says when we see him, we shall see him as he is. For it doth not yet appear what we shall be, right? So you still under construction, no matter how together you think you have it. It's okay to have a Kodak moment as long as the camera's not watching. You can weep before God. You can talk to God. There's no posturing or tradition. If it's at the stoplight, get it on. If it's in the hull of a ship, get it on. If it's in the empty house before everybody gets home, get it on. But you're going to need to be broken to be made better. You can be a man with everybody else, but you better be a child before God. And he loves you enough to look at you in your broken state and fix you. He'll do it. Come unto me, all ye that are burdened and heavy laden. Huh? For my yoke is easy and my burden is light, and I will give you rest. He's waiting on you. You ain't waiting on him. He's been begging you to be broken through your circumstances. How long? This has gone wrong. That has gone wrong. This has happened. That has happened. And you still refuse to bow. You can come or he can drag you. The choice is yours. Watch this. Matthew 18, 1 through 4. Matthew 18, 1 through 4. Proof that vulnerability is a prerequisite for worship. We just did Psalms 51. That's contrition and brokenness. That's what it says. Not me, but thee. It says, broken and contrite. That's what it says. Now, Matthew 18, 1 through 4. At the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus called a little child unto him and set him in the midst of them and said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. From the mouth of God himself. Now, I don't know about you, but I ain't seen a child can do it all. Children need help. They are the express image of vulnerability. When they first get here, you got to wipe them and you got to feed them. And then as they grow up, you know, you got to clothe them and make sure they get good educations. Give them as much help as you can and as much head start as you have ability. They come here needy. You got to come to God that way. He says, unless you be as one of these, it's amazing to me how many layers we put on. And some of us haven't been new before God in years because we've been steady hiding and handling. Hiding what we can't deal with and handling what we can. Here is the model for vulnerability. I don't have to tell y'all, it's Jesus Christ. Isaiah 53, 3 through 8. Isaiah 53, 3 through 8. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. We hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath bore our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. What's more vulnerable than to have your entrails exposed through your ribs as a cattail rips the flesh off your back? What's more vulnerable than to be hung high and stretched wide? What's more vulnerable than to have a railroad spike thrust between the metatarsals of your wrist? What's more vulnerable than to be pierced in your side? What's more vulnerable than to be naked, to have your beard plucked and your back given to the smiters? He is the epitome of excellency in the field of endeavor known as vulnerability. He is a shining example to every man and boy here. The Lord have laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is bought as a lamb to the slaughter and as a sheep before shearers is dumb. So he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. New Testament, Philippians 2, 7 through 8. But he made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, being found in fashion as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You must possess discernment concerning the expression of your vulnerability. You can't show it to everybody. You can't share it with everybody. Pray about it. Proverbs 4 and 23. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Joseph is a prime example of timing and vulnerability. Genesis 45, 1 through 2. Then Joseph could not refrain himself before all them that stood by him, and he cried, cause every man to go out from me. And there stood no man with him while Joseph made himself known unto his brethren, and he wept aloud. And the Egyptians and the house of Pharaoh heard. He put everybody out the room but his inner circle, and he had a moment. And he manifested the pain and anguish of a 17-year-old boy who had been sold into captivity and betrayed by his own brethren, who had now become a 30-year-old man with a signet ring on, second in command of all he surveyed under Pharaoh, able to save his entire lineage because he was obedient to God. The next time you struggle with vulnerability, and I'm going to close, I need you to remember this, the shortest yet most profound verse in the Word of God, arguably, John 11:35. And Jesus wept. If it was good enough for God, it's good enough for you. Let us bow our heads. God, we thank you and we bless you today for your word, for your wisdom and your way. Help us, God, to practice the art of vulnerability until we perfect it. Give us discernment to be able to govern the good from the goodness of God and to realize with whom we should be what you have assigned us to be, O God. We thank you and we bless you for the wisdom of the ages revealed today in your word. In Jesus' name, amen.